Ladies and gentlemen, the Kids in the Room Podcast!
The Kids in the Room Podcast!
That's right.
That's right.
Brought to you by Moo Faces TV.
Woo! All right. Hey guys, welcome to the Kids in the Room Podcast. Today we've got Matt Alonzo on the show.
Yo, whoa.
We got Matt Alonzo. Matt Alonzo, if you guys don't know, has been the actual, you know, the omega, the almighty of the film directing and music videos. You know, you've done, let them know what you've done, because you've done so much shit, man. Like, they need to know. Yeah. Let the people know.
Thank you for the introduction. For those who do not know, which there's a ton of youngsters out there, but I'm your favorite director's favorite director, pretty much. Well, I've done everything from, you know, Chris Cornell, which is, you know, more rock, all the way to Justin Bieber, Soulja Boy, Turn My Swag On, and I built one of the first YouTube channels ever, pretty much, with DJ Ski, and I've done a variety of branded projects and just kind of built a little empire of content and creating with brands, and I consider music artists as brands as well. So everyone from Bieber to Chris Cornell and beyond, a lot of rap videos, Game, Lil Wayne, all those type of people.
I mean, you're holding out a little bit too. You also did like,
yeah, I just forget.
You were part of an era at that time. And I remember yeah, like we were all doing different things at that time, but it was, you know, of course we crossed paths a lot. Mm-hmm. But I remember, you know, it was what, Tie Me Down, New Boys. You guys did
You're a Jerk.
Yep, You're a Jerk. Like a G6. That was big. G6 was big. Like those are big huge artists. You put them.
Yeah, yeah.
That music video put them on the map.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. The visuals definitely, you know, we did a lot of first time videos for, you know, new artists, and having DJ Ski, you know, helping us, you know, figure out which records we were going to shoot. We set up ourselves for success, and we knocked everything out of the park. So it was a fun time. And that was kind of like the digital revolution. That's when people were shooting on film, and we were the first ones to shoot on the Red, first ones to shoot on the 5D, 7D, and kind of changed the whole game unknowingly.
Yeah, I mean, you know, walk us through the journey before the Tie Me Down, before the Ski TV. You know, back to Matt when he was at, you know, Brooks, you know, and, you know, his parents helped him get to film school. Let's bring it back.
Yeah.
Let's walk him through it.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, we grew up, low, and I would just say middle class. And I just couldn't afford to go to film school. My parents it wasn't something within our budget. But I was working for the city of Santa Barbara, helping a friend out at the film school that I wanted to attend. And he pulled my parents aside and said, "Hey, Matt's helping me with my projects. He's getting A's on everything, and he needs to be here. So, you know, I would really, you know, highly suggest that you guys take a look one more time and see if you guys can get him here." And they ended up getting me, allowing me to go and pulling out some loans and stuff for me to be able to, you know, further my education as a filmmaker. And that's kind of when it clicked in my brain that, all right, this is what I'm going to do for the rest of my life, and I'm going to take it seriously. So when I graduated, I already had a full-time job from an internship that I had done out in LA. So I was going to school, driving to LA for an internship, turned into a full-time job. But then I quit out of nowhere. I couldn't do it. It was too corporate for me. And so I lost my apartment, my car, and just went to Craigslist and found, you know, just kept hustling, because in my mind, I was like living somewhere else. I was like, all right, I already know what I want to do. So whatever happens right now, whatever I endure, I just have to persevere through it and I'll be fine. Like I wasn't very present in that time, like in my life. I was so in the future in my head, just knowing where I was wanted to be. So an opportunity came for a concert in San Diego, and I got paid $100. Lil Wayne was the headlining act. I didn't know that till we got there. And I took that footage home. This was 2007. So YouTube was like in its infancy. I mean, it was, you know, people weren't really on there like that at all. And I cut it up, put some split screens, did all this, you know, really high level editing at the time, and put it out as Lil Wayne's official music video. And I labeled it as such. And the next day it boomed. It went everywhere. And DJ Ski, being Game's DJ and kind of, you know, always breaking products and being involved with like the hottest trends and stuff, he just started shooting himself on a cell phone, and kind of like, I don't even know what the cell phone was back then, like a BlackBerry? I don't even know. Maybe it wasn't a cell phone. Yeah, no, because it was a BlackBerry for sure. It was actually before the BlackBerry. And so
Palm Pilot or some shit?
Yeah. It was like
one of those.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Cause I actually didn't get a, I remember I got a BlackBerry when I was with Ski, like when I was actually, you know, we're partners. So I definitely, yeah. He must have been shooting on like a little one chip camera because that was all that was out at the time. It was like mini DV tapes.
Right.
Yeah. And the Lil Wayne concert, actually, I filmed in 1920 by 1080, which was a huge thing at the time because, you know, before that it was 720 by 480, which now seems like so small, but that's what the standard was, you know? So yeah, we teamed up and he had all the access and, you know, all these great connections and I would say like 2 months later, we were shooting Game and Travis Barker and New Boys, You're a Jerk and Felt Like a G6 and everything kind of just kept snowballing. And we were able to premiere all the videos on our channel back then. So we were able to take all those analytics and then go pitch them to brands to get commercials and you know, 10-second intros because Vivo wasn't even out. Nothing was out at the time. So we were kind of the pioneers of that. And that's what we did. So... It was just a whole different era, you know, whole different era.
Completely different era. I mean, from where we are now. Now it's like it seems a little bit easier, but then there's other new pros and cons mm-hmm. that kicked in now because the algorithms have changed on YouTube yep. and et cetera, and the media.
There was no algorithms back then.
Right, you just threw shit on there, and it just like it did yeah. what it did. And
I mean, back then that was like when the I don't know if you remember the treadmill video. Remember the like the music video with the treadmill? It was like the most watched video at the time.
Fucking
yeah, I mean, this like YouTube was. I started looking back at the actual interface and everything, and I was like, man, yeah, there was. I don't think there was an algorithm at all. I'm curious actually now. I should do a little research on that, but yeah, you just kind of put stuff up there, and no one really cared too much. It wasn't like it was, you know, they didn't believe. I don't think they trusted it as a platform yet, you know.
No, it wasn't there at that period of time for sure. I mean, I think that was around still when MySpace was still kind of hanging around.
Oh yeah, yeah. Oh yeah, MySpace was popping. Yeah. That's when that's how I had all my stuff up on MySpace.
It's crazy.
Yep.
Yeah. So how did the New Boys situation come to you guys? Like, was that all like how did that happen?
I mean, you know, Ski just being tapped in. He was the head DJ over at Power 106, you know, and he was just always in the mix and he was always breaking products and like kind of known for breaking artists, like Akon and the products. He was always breaking the new cell phones. And so he kind of just kept with that trend and he was just always in the know. And I remember I don't know if it was Your Jerk. Yeah, Your Jerk. I didn't really like the song. I'm like, I don't, you know, cause it was like a dance song. It was like, jerk, 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 you know? And he's like, no, we're going to shoot this video. And I'm like, and he's like, Matt, you know, talk to me a little bit about like, hey, it doesn't really matter what you like as a person. Let's just look at things as a business. I was very young. I was 22 at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And then it clicked. I was like, all right. Song went number one and video went number one. And, you know, kind of we were very selective after that. I don't know exactly how it came. I just know that Ski, you know, had all these connections. He was always DJing. He was always, you know, in the mix. And now he had a production company and a director and a full crew that he believed in and he was ready to take on any of those jobs that's what we could do. So, and he just wanted to continue to build out the content so that he could leverage it with ads, which I mean, thinking back on it, it's genius, you know, but at the time no one really understood it. And we actually caused Vivo to be created because we were premiering all our videos kind of like Cole Bennett does now. We did that 15 years ago. So, but yeah, I mean, that was kind of how that, you know, that went down. I don't know if they're in the studio or if Ski was playing the record and then he's just like, hey, let us shoot the video. And they were like, of course. He was really good friends with Chris Clancy over at Interscope, who's now Tyler, the Creator, Frank Ocean, all Odd Future people like manager.
Mm-hmm.
So he was the head of marketing at Interscope at the time. And he was, you know, he was the one giving us all these opportunities. And New Boys wasn't signed to Interscope, but I think one of their business, whoever they were signed to was friends with him. And so that's how it all connected. So,
yeah, I remember at one point in time, like Ben and Jay were, you know, kind of working with Nick Cannon for a while because we would go mm-hmm. different places with them and we're like, all right. I'm like, hey, what's up, Ben and Jay? They would be around all the time. It's like, yeah, man, tie me down. Yeah.
And then they broke up.
Yeah, they did. I mean, that's what happened.
Yeah, I watched the interview. Like on, I don't remember what it was on, but Vlad TV, I think. And I was like, dang, I didn't know what happened to them.
Did it get nasty? I'm gonna watch it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Over a girl or something. And then I don't even think they talk to this day.
Wow.
The boys, yeah.
It's crazy like how just, the like, randomly just
up and left, like left the tour or something, or left what? Just left the hotel and just never came back. Legacy did.
Wow. Yeah. They were cool, man, for a while.
But at the same time. Yeah, at the same time, it's like, yo, there's 16, 17-year-old kids who just got fame thrown at them and all this attention and money. And I mean, although be it a short while, it's just sometimes it's just, you know, overwhelming, which is understandable, especially if you don't have, you know, supportive parents or management or just people who are going to explain things to you and kind of put priorities in order for you. So they're good kids. I just think it was just overwhelming.
Yeah, I mean, that it happens to you, man. Out of nowhere, you just become Absolutely. Famous and celebrities and things like that. So what was like, yeah. like when you were shooting, you shot numerous of people. What are some of the highlights and exciting points of some of your directing of music videos?
Yeah, I think, so let's take a look here. I mean, there's a couple of different like benchmarks, I guess I would say. One of the most memorable times, and I think something that was not many people can say, directors even, is that, you know, I went and shot in Iraq with Exhibit. We shot a music video over there. But
was that Napalm? Let's
go visit. Huh? Yeah.
My friend so Missy we was actually with you.
Huh?
My friend Missy was actually with you.
Yeah?
Yeah, she was.
Was she protecting? Like, wait, oh, she was with us?
Yeah, she did. She did something. She was doing something with X. What was it? She was doing like some type of event management or something like that with like things like that with X.
Yeah,
yeah. He called her the merch girl.
Oh, I don't remember.
Yeah, back in the day. But carry on.
I don't remember. I don't remember. It was just, I just remember us. Like, I just remember it was just being crazy because I was scared of flying, and it was like we're in Blackhawks and all this stuff. And he's like, "Yo, you have to go. There's no way." He called me. He's like, "There's no way." I'm like, "Nah, I'm cool," because I thought about the flying and stuff. I'm like, Kuwait, all these, you know, 15 hours.
Yeah.
Like, dude, you're not saying no. Like, it doesn't matter. I don't care. Get your bags packed. So that was something that, you know, that just that experience. And then, you know, obviously having a lot of alone time with him and being able to just kind of soak up some of his knowledge was amazing. And then being in, you know, Iraq, Baghdad,
crazy,
the most dangerous place in the world. You know what I mean? In Blackhawks, you know, with open doors and just filming out of them, like, you know, fully inverted, like in you know, it was
wild.
It was pretty insane. Yeah, I have all the footage too. You know, we never really did anything other than the music video with it. But that was something obviously that's big. The time that I spent with Nipsey was relatively similar to that as far as you know, just insight and like, you know, how to run the game, like how to do good business. You know, not only, you know, from the creative standpoint, I think I kind of had a lot of things, you know, figured out. And I was always learning, but business wise, it was hard for me as a creative, just being able to turn the other hat on. So, you know, hearing Nipsey talk to Rick Ross, and it was me and Nipsey for like, I think 3 weeks out in Europe. And it was just me and him and Fats, his other manager. And we just stayed in the same, me and Nipsey stayed in the same room. And just, I just got a lot of game there. So that was.
What kind of stuff did Nipsey, you know, that you feel that you, there are some takeaways that Nipsey kind of taught you?
I mean, more than anything, he was just such a respectful and like positive energy to be around, which was just something refreshing and
different.
It's really hard to explain. Even like Demrick, when I got back, I'd be listening to Nipsey music and he'd be like, "What is it? Like, what exactly?" And I'm like, I can't put my finger on exactly what it is. It's just the energy, the aura, just the way that he moves. That is like, it's just captivating. And it just, you know, draws you close. And he's just so, he cares about people and he's very genuine.
Right.
And, you know, you believe him. And so that is something that's just, you know, in our industry, it's like not.
And common something at that, all?
Yeah, it's not common. It's not really common. And it's not that quick. You're usually not that quick to like, you know, want to ride with somebody or like, you know, take what they have to say to like straight to heart. So,
right.
So it was very, it was just new for me. It was different. And it was just like refreshing. And he'd be on the phone with Rick Ross, and Rick Ross wanted to sign him to like $1 million 360 deal. And he was like, he was telling me, he's like, "Nah, you know, I'm cool. I'll take a look at it, whatever." And then he hung up and he was just like, he's like, "Don't ever do that, man." He's like, he's going to take everything I've worked for $1 million, it's not worth it, you know?
Right.
And he's like, you know, just make it, you know, make it on your own. And, but we, you know, we shot a whole documentary, and that was something for me that, you know, obviously that he passed was, it made it even that much bigger, but just at, even when he passed, my dad called me, cause he knew how important that trip was, and just that time, and how highly I thought of him, that he called me right away, actually.
Right.
But I mean, everybody from Bieber was, you know, was really cool. And then Common, Nas, I mean, Common took me aside as soon as I met him. Hey, how's it going? My name's Matt. Hey, come with me into my trailer. I'm like, oh shoot, I'm in trouble or something, you know?
Fucking teachers.
He's like, all right, let's bow our heads. And, you know, thank God for Matt. And I'm like, all right, that's cool. It's different than like, hey, where's the blunts? Hey, you got my bottles.
You sound
stuff,
like YG, you know? For a second.
Hey, no, YG be? I shot a lot with YG.
Yeah,
popping, you know.
Yeah, last time I saw him was a Playground Festival, behind backstage and stuff like that. Yeah, when he was with Echo, good guy.
Yeah, YG's good people.
Yeah, he is.
Good people, man.
So
I've never had really bad experiences, except for my first experience with Game. Other than that,
what was that? What do you mean first experience? What was that?
My first video was Dope Boys with Travis Barker.
Sick.
And like, but we had like, you know, Esteban Oreo and all the, you know, because he was kind of a staple at the time. And then I was, you know, he was film. He was, you know, he was doing these big budget videos and documentaries. I kind of came into the game and took all his Interscope clients for 10 grand. So there was like tension there, which was awkward, you know, as a 22-year-old kid, you know.
And you were taking that from who at the time? Sorry.
Like Esteban, just the older directors who were shooting on film.
Right,
who were,
right.
Who were getting 200, 300,000 for videos. I mean, that was relatively
right.
The norm, like, you know, normal budget, you know, that I'm coming in here doing these things for 10 grand.
Get that fucking guy out
with
of
this
here.
New, like with this new digital camera, like who, like, you know, there was just a lot of,
hate.
They're just kind of wait. Yeah. They're not really, I mean, yeah. Hate, but also just kind of waiting for me to fall. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, I know exactly what you mean,
which I get. I mean, I understand, but you know, so that was a little, you know, that was a little awkward. Like I never experienced that ever after that too much. But and then just having Game is a, you know, I think with any sort of brand or celebrity or artist, you're gonna have to win their trust a little bit. You know what I mean? Because at the end of the day, they are putting their brand, their name, their face, you know, their career
in your hands. I mean,
essentially, yeah, in your hands. You know, and a 22-year-old kid with a huge shot list. You know, like. Hi, you know, hey, so this is what we're gonna do, and he's like, "Who is this kid?" You know, and then I had all these girls that were supposed to be in the video, supposed to be a bunch of girls that were like breaking up the drugs, and he was like, "No," he's like, "If they're not naked, that's not." Like, they were like bright pink bathing suits and stuff.
Yeah, I think I sent some fucking people to you a couple times.
Yeah, probably, man. Like, oh man, and I was like, now looking back, I was like, what was I thinking? But so he was like, so then. Then he's like, whose decision was, you know, whose idea was that? And I was like, oh, it was mine. But I didn't really think about it like so much like that. Cause obviously you do have girls there who are, you know, shorting your drugs, you're not going to have them in clothes cause they might steal stuff. Right. So, but I was just a youngster. Yeah. You know, he's like, you have them naked so that they don't take anything. And he's like, but luckily, you know, a good friend of mine now, Lulu and Omar Cruz was signed to Interscope. And so he had all his homies who were like in all the Training Day movies and all that stuff.
Sick.
So they just popped their shirts off and then they replaced them. But still, Game wasn't very like, he didn't know who I was. Like he had never seen any of my work and did nothing out. So, but then once that video came out, then he was like, all right, like, I don't even have to read the treatments. You know what you're doing. You make me look good. So I trust you.
Yeah, that's the thing, man. It's like in the industry, when you're first getting out there, no matter how good you are, you've got to earn your stripes because nobody fucking trusts you because nobody really knows you. And just because one person knows you doesn't mean shit. And it's crazy how that works. Crazy.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. I mean, and it's like, it's just like anything else. I mean, you can be the best basketball player, but if nobody knows you, then nobody knows you. Like, you're not the best. You know what I mean? Like, you do have to, you know, put yourself out there and go outside of your comfort zone and prove that you're the best on many different platforms. And I mean, that's when you actually challenge yourself and you rise to the occasion and you show who you really are. So, you know, it's funny looking back on it now. I was overprepared and just kind of a little, I mean, I was used to being on film school sets and, you know, pretty organized sets, but I mean, I'm talking like huge shot lists and really like more narrative based, you know, cinematic, like feature style shooting. So when you show up to a music video, they're kind of just like, they want to know where to stand. They want to hear the song a couple times and they want to know where the girls are at or whatever. You know what I mean? Like, it's, they don't really care about your camera moves and like all this other stuff.
Right.
They don't need to know that.
So I think, Matt, like what are some, like for you, I think it's like, what kind of like motivated you to, you know, keep on going with directing and things like that? Like, I know you said you got into Brooks Institute, your friend, you know, said you needed to join in, your parents helped you out, and you started killing it. But like, you had to have some type of confidence to keep on going.
Oh yeah.
Where does that come from?
I mean, I've put in, you know, 12 hours, 7 days a week for 20 years, you know? So when you know you work that hard, not only work hard, but you've been proven to, you know, I have a proven product, you know, like, sometimes I would have post house edit for me and I'd have to take the edit away and then I'd re-edit and I'd have the manager or the owner of the post house, this big post house, call me and be like, hey, you're really good. You know? So I've had those type of things where I was reassured, not only with the actual hours that I put in, but then, you know, with the product that I'm putting out in those hours. So, and then just being able to set myself up with like systems for like writing treatments, systems for every aspect that, you know, every channel of the actual, I guess the delivery line of the product, you know, it kind of just gives you confidence because you're running an oiled machine at that point, you know? So it's not like you kind of know how it's going to, you know, the wheels are turning. So as long as it's, you know, the light's on green, it's going to deliver that product or whatever it is. So, and also just this, at the end of the day, I was always very confident in my skills and just me as a person. I never had too many insecurities. I think it was the way I was raised, you know. I was always raised with to like have a voice, and my parents always, you know, let me talk even when I was grounded, like when I was a little kid. So I've always had a voice that's been allowed to be heard through my parents. So
right.
I think that had a lot to do with it. So, the only time I did get insecure and stuff like that was when I, you know, I signed to ICM as a feature film director, and I said fear of failure. I just try to control everything too much, which obviously if you have managers and stuff like that, that's what they're in charge of. So you're not supposed to be really, you're supposed to just be asking questions, soaking in what they're saying and kind of, you know, doing what they ask and going above and beyond. But when you want to control things as a young kid, because you're unsure of the unknown, then, which is ironic, right? Because everything's unknown. So.
I mean, I get it. You don't want to fucking fail. I mean, especially when everything's on riding on you, your name, your brand. You work so hard to be where you are. So I can feel where you're coming from.
It was less like that. It was, I mean, I guess that had, you know, that was there, but I think I don't know. Yeah. I was just scared to take the next step because music videos were so easy for me. I had the product line going already. So I I'm like, why try something new that I might not do well at if I can just stay here. Although that, you know, features was the goal. So it's just a little ironic, but it definitely taught me a lot. Now that I'm a manager of an artist, now I'm like, okay, now I can see, I understand how I have a lot of empathy and cognitive empathy where I can understand like where he's coming from. So it definitely, you know, helps me out now. But other than that though, I kind of just knew I was the shit. I still think I'm like the best. So
yeah, I mean, you know. Top down. I mean, let's be honest. There aren't that many music video directors that are as solid as you. There's a couple out there, but you're definitely one of the top. You're definitely a Spielberg in your own, you know?
Let's just be real. I appreciate that very much.
Let's be real.
Yeah.
But like, yeah. I think like, you know, when you started putting everything together, like, how did you know, like on the set, like what it took to make an actual music video as far as like the teams and who you need to put together to actually create this, you need a DP and et cetera. Like, could you describe that for, you know, people out there who don't really know? What are the core components of shooting a film or a music video?
That's a great, great, great question. Great question. Actually, you know, before I went to film school, I didn't even know that cameras had lenses. That's how advanced I was. You know, but when I went to film school, I learned a lot, and I have to give a lot of credit to Brooks. It was an amazing institution.
Yes.
It was a lot of hands-on stuff where, you know, we were shooting a lot of projects. Actually, every 6 weeks we were shooting, like all the time. So it was a lot of hands-on stuff. And then you obviously mimicked whatever at the time, I guess, was the industry standard, which is still pretty much is. Everything's still pretty, like, it transfers now, even, you know, the education. So we learned a lot about just crew, set etiquette, how things are run, what each department is in charge of. And that just flowed right over into music videos. It's a little bit, you know, looser or in different in some aspects, but other than it's pretty much the same, you know? And so I was a director. I didn't have a camera. I had a little Panasonic. Actually, I still have it. HVX or DBX, excuse me.
Right. You got to have the DBX. And,
I still have mine. And so I didn't have a crew or anything. So when I got with Ski, there was a rapper who had met a bunch of film guys who had cameras and lights, but they didn't necessarily direct. None of them directed. So they were kind of looking for a director. I was looking for a crew. And so they connected us on like a three-way call. And that's how I you know, met my crew for the first like 5 or 6 years of my career. You know, I had DP, camera operator, first AC, producer, and a couple grips. And that's kind of what they did. They didn't want to direct. They didn't want to be videographers. They didn't want to be anything. They just wanted to be those set positions. And then I just wanted to be a director, editor. So that's where I stepped in. And they had graduated film school as well. So we all kind of just knew set etiquette and who was responsible for what just by film school. And they worked at a rental house as well. So that really helped out. So on a set, you know, normally the director will write the idea and come up with the actual concept. And, you know, your DP, director of photography, is going to be in charge of, you know, the lighting aspects of the camera. If the director allows them to, a lot of times I'll micromanage that a little bit. I've gotten better or worse, depends, I guess, on the job. Now for bigger jobs, I mean, you're going to have a DP, your DP is going to have a gaffer, which is like his main guy, the guy who actually does all the work that he tells him to do. And then he'll have a guy, a key grip and a few other regular grips and electrics, who are those the guys who set up the stands and things like that. So you have that, then you have your camera department, you have your camera operator who operates the camera, because most DPs actually don't, especially the bigger ones, don't even touch the camera. Directors usually never touch the camera, absolutely, like never. But so you have your camera operator, and then you have the first or second AC who are in charge of your, you know, switching out lenses, making sure all the glass is clean, accessories are charged, etc. And then you'll have your producer who pretty much manages all the money. I mean, they're in charge of all the where all the money's going.
And you're saying you're executive producer?
We never really. I mean, the executive producer would just kind of be like, I mean, because it just depends on how big the job is, you know. Like, and for most jobs, especially anything under like 10,000-15,000, I don't even have any of that stuff on there, because you just can't. I mean, it's just there's no room for margin for you know, to make any money. And then you have your set production, your production design, you know, anything like that, your props, special effects. So it just depends on the job, you know, but just down to like the core essentials, usually it's just the director, DP, a camera op or somebody in the camera department to manage all that stuff. And maybe one or two hands and, you know, a truck full of lights.
Gotta have those. So another question, another question is on top of that is, you know, what are some of the typical ways that you've, you know, how have you maintained your network? Like, as far as like networking with people and, you know, finding new people to work with and things like that. How are you building that? Like, how do you keep up with that?
I'm very thankful for, you know, social media and just kind of the brand that I was able to kind of establish at the time. I mean, to be honest, I haven't put together a new reel since 2011. So I was really bad with networking I would say my first 4 or 5 years of, you know, being out here as a professional. Right. I didn't understand the importance of it. I just wanted to work. And I thought that was, if I worked harder, worked more hours, then I would get to my destination faster. Obviously, right. We know that's not true.
Right.
And networking is a huge, absolutely. I mean, it is, I would say it's bigger than talent. You know, like there's a lot of people I know who are not very good at what they do, but they network really well and gotten tremendous opportunities. And if you get the opportunities, you just need somebody to kind of help you out. You get a good DP, you get a good XYZ, and you're going to make something okay, you know? So networking is really key. For me, I kind of built my brand, thankfully, with Ski. Like, you know, we didn't have that much capital at the time. We were a startup company. So The one thing that I did do was to make sure that I branded everything, which is Matt Alonso, Matt Alonso, Matt Alonso. It was everywhere. Matt Alonso Presents in the beginning of every video, so that my name was just synonymous with good work. And that really still kind of holds true. And like I said, I haven't created an updated reel since 2011. So any job that I've been getting has just been kind of word of mouth, or, you know, they're like, oh man, I used to watch your videos when I was like 2 years old. I'm like, oh no.
Dude, what? Are you sure?
I remember you when I was in preschool. I'm like,
what? How? You're not that old. You're still pretty young. What the hell?
Dude, it's crazy, man. I'm like, yeah. But that's, you know, and then, you know, just always having those, you know, I've always had, like, any artist that I've shot kind of like has gone on to do, you know, really, really big things. And so, you know, I've been very thankful to have really good opportunities that kind of keep my name in the mix. And to be honest, I haven't even really pursued music videos lately, but I get tons of calls. So very thankful for that. But a lot of it is networking, you know what I mean? Just checking in with people, making sure, you know, that you're keeping those relationships and friendships, you know, just at least alive, you know what I mean? And it is a kind of a 50-50 thing where you do have to, you know, put some effort in and show that, that, you know, you genuinely care about the other person's wellness and how they're doing. So those little things go a long way. It's kind of like just a reminder, because out of sight, out of mind. But if it's like, hey, you should send an email or text or call, or you see somebody out, boom, next thing, oh man, I have an artist, blah, blah, blah. And I just signed this artist, Ella May. We need a video. She's leaving to, you know, she's leaving out to the UK in like 2 days. Can you shoot her with $5? Yeah, no problem. Then Ella May blows up, you know, like stuff like that. So it's just kind of like, you know, just keeping your face, you know.
But I think what I'm saying too is more, Matt, is like, as far as like, you know, your team, your production team, you know, when you're, you know, how do you keep, you know, tabs on that? Like, as far as like who you're working with, who's your DP and et cetera, like, how do you keep control of your team? So that way, when you're doing things,
I don't.
There's that team. How does that? Well, really?
No, you don't. I mean, you, when I was with Ski, we kind of had almost, I would say, like almost like on staff, on salary. They weren't on salary, but we had so many jobs that they basically didn't have to ever look beyond us to get work. And so we kind of kept everything relatively in-house, you know. But as time went on, and you know, I like to, you know, I don't ever want to restrict anybody from anything, you know what I mean? Because as a creative, as a freelancer, we need to take advantage of every opportunity that we get. So I'm just very, I had to do this. This was one thing that really kind of helped me out tremendously and actually hurt me a lot, was that I didn't communicate very well. I didn't communicate to myself very well. I didn't communicate my ideas mm-hmm. to, you know, out loud and, you know, in a way that I could understand, and then in a way that I could actually give to each department so that they knew what I wanted.
Right.
And what was going to be expected of them. So once I learned that, then that's when I was able to kind of keep control without keeping control.
Right.
And that's what you want to do. You want to give everybody the freedom. And then some people, you know, as long as you communicate what's going to be expected, they can tell you if they can't do it or if it's too much for whether the money or they have other projects, or like, hey, I can DP this, but I can't give you 2 prep days. And, you know, I can't draw up lighting diagrams or whatever. Right. Like, but if you don't tell them that, and you're just kind of expecting it, and then it just gets really weird. So it does, you know, because you're, and then it's like passive aggressive type stuff, or like vice versa. Maybe they're expecting something from you and they don't get it. So they're like, well, I can't make an equipment list because I haven't got the shot list yet or whatever.
Right.
And so it's just about communicating, because that stuff does happen, you know. Mm-hmm. So it's just about communicating, being upfront. And your job as a director, you know, and as a guy, is really to be able to communicate your idea to everybody in a way that's going to inspire and motivate them to add their twist and then put their full effort into it. So, but as far as like on, like, you know, in an actual project, I just check in with the lead heads, make sure that they have all the, you know, the information. I make sure first to flush out all the information that I need, and that they're going to need so that they can do their job.
Right.
And then I call them and we individually go through everything and then kind of keep me updated on everything, or the producer will do that as well. So kind of how I rock and roll.
Yeah. So pretty much what you're still kind of like doing things more, not necessarily virtually, you're doing mostly things kind of manually.
Yeah. I don't like text messages. I don't like any personal, you know, like communication. It's really like, you know, a lot of mix up, a lot of things happen there, a lot of, you know, just miscommunication and things like that. So I just try to keep everything as easy as possible, you know? Mm-hmm. And yeah, I mean, I haven't really, I mean, what do you mean virtually? Is there something I'm missing? Like,
I'm digging in. I'm just saying,
I'm curious. Like, no. I'm sure people, yeah, I don't know. Yeah. It's just kind of, no, I just, I guess. Yeah.
I think like for what I'm saying is like, you know, Matt is like, there's so much shit going on set. And it's like, mm-hmm. how do you maintain sanity and organization without tools?
Oh, you're just
like without like new tools. Like, how do you manage your payroll? How do you manage when somebody needs to be, you know, off when they're done, right? Their extra needs to leave, you know, make sure they're not going overtime.
Oh, no, that's very easy. I mean, yeah, remember, this is like 15 years. So I have all that stuff pretty much down to a system now. And one thing as a director, I've taken on a lot of other hats that I probably shouldn't necessarily wear. But like when I'm writing my shot list, I write my shot list out based on the actual treatment of the script or whatever, right? The actual mm-hmm. story, like how it's going to be. But I try to keep everything relatively, you know, simple. I try to keep it all in the same spot. I might have like four different scenes that look completely different, but they're going to be one right here, one literally right there. And then, you know, so I try to keep everything relatively tight. I try to keep everything, you know, in control and then be considerate of my guys' time. Like everybody on the crew, their time, their effort. Like if I'm not paying them, if it's a smaller job, maybe it's a bigger name, but who cares, right? Like it's all about making sure that you're giving everything that you can to them, because they're not getting the credit. They're on to the next job, you know? So, mm-hmm. But if you put them first and you show that you're thinking about them, like, hey, you're not using this location and having one scene, you know, in the front of the building, one scene all the way in the back and then coming all the way back to the front to shoot another scene. You're not like doing stuff like that, because people do things like that. You know, it just shows that you know what you're doing, that you're considerate of them, and people will go to bat for you. So if you keep everything controlled in a limited space, you have your extras or your people come in only when you're going to need them to shoot. And you kind of get them in, get out. My whole thing is that like kind of like an AD. I just want to get people in and out, mm-hmm. you know, like they're kind of my muse. Like I want to make sure you're okay, but I don't really care too much. Like mm-hmm. how you feel on set, like, especially like, you know, talent. I'm like, let me just do what I got to do. Get in, get out. And as long as that you're organized as a director or the head of production or who, you know, that main, everything trickles down from you. But a lot of directors, you know, you're creative. So you're creative. You're not sometimes not organized, or you want to kind of be inspired in the moment and right, kind of right. come up with ideas. And that's where chaos just happens. So the more prepared you can be, the better it'll run. And that's kind of how I've maintained control, is just being able to know exactly what I want, keep everybody engaged and always to the next thing. So,
yeah. So you're pretty much on the fly. I mean, there's no, like, you're not using any type of like, you know, digital interfaces to kind of keep track of everything. You're kind of like manual, like, hey, you this, you that, and et cetera. And
well, yeah, I'll write it all out, do everything. You know what I mean? I'll have everything, you know, we'll go through a prep day or at least a walkthrough of the location. Okay, first scene's going to be here. Let's put a, you know, I won't even say the lights. I'll just say, hey, I want a hard source here. You know, let's just do a high contrast ratio, whatever lights you want to use. I want a couple colors in the background or whatever. And then we'll move on to the next. And I'll be like, okay, this each setup, I'm going to shoot five different lenses. And I'm going to shoot multiple frame rates of each of them. So we're probably going to shoot 20 takes here. So I just kind of prep everybody into understanding what it's going to be. And so, yeah, I don't. Anything else? There's no need for anything else, I don't think, you know, mm-hmm. until I guess, I mean, if you're doing visual effects, you're doing anything that has certain elements to it, then yeah, I could understand. But for the normal stuff, I think that kind of anything other than that would kind of complicate it more for me right. personally.
Right.
Have like this, you know, because I have gotten contacted by a few apps that kind of do that, like the management of things. But I was just very confused on what the game was going to be for me.
Right.
So yeah, I never explored those too much.
Yeah, like,
but
what were
the new people?
What were they like? What kind of things did they? What problems were they trying to solve?
Management of projects. So like, I guess all the documents but like my producer or I handles everything. I have a Google Drive that I'll have, you know, folder in. I'll have them have access to it. And we'll have really well organized folders inside there. All the documents, templates are already in there. Budget, everything we need. So W-9s. And then the way they should handle everything is you just make production books for each project and, you know, with all your receipts and your budget and all that stuff. So so that you kind of have each project as like a individual job or individual product. And and it's a lot easier to make. To
right. So like basically that. Like the flow that you kind of have, your workflow is already pretty much it's mature. Mm-hmm. You already have it. You're ready to launch anytime. So it's just like anytime. Getting into Same different thing. Flows will just like break things for you because you're already into this habit forming thing.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, and something that I've cultivated and kind of molded and added and subtracted from for, you know, 15 years with multiple different production companies and director reps and different personnel. And I've kind of found what works for everybody. What's the easiest? I mean, all the way down to like, I'll print out invoices and just bring them on set and just have people write in their amount with, you know, I already have their address, everything on there. And all you have to do is just sign the amount and then sign that they received their money. I don't have to have them send me an invoice because then sometimes they don't, or they forget, or they're on to the next job. They fly out to, you know, wherever to shoot a feature for 30 days. They get home, they don't remember. You got to do taxes. You don't have the. So it's like, I just bring it, sign it, done. You know, it's like all the way down to that. You know what I mean? So I just keep it very simple for everybody. And the crew appreciates it. It's easy for me. And then it's all done. It's all tight and that's what works for me. I mean,
right.
Everybody can explore their own.
And like most of your shots or most of your shoots, are they typically in Los Angeles or are you out and about?
I'm mobile. I mean, I'll go anywhere. Come on, hit me up. I go everywhere. Like, I mean, obviously now with so many filmmakers, it's, you know, why it doesn't make much sense to fly somebody all the way out and pay for all this stuff. But I do it when the opportunities present themselves, if they make sense for me.
Is it more noisier than it was previously? As far as filmmakers?
Yeah. I mean, you know, back when, you know, 2008, 9, 10, like, you know, like I was getting flown out everywhere because, you know, and we're still, if you're, you know, a commodity, you're going to get invited to places as far as like other states to shoot in. But I mean, I feel like every state has, you know, tons of filmmakers with reds and production companies, and they may not be the best or whatever, but they're in the neighborhood and they're active in networking and trying to get their opportunities. So why would you fly somebody out, pay for all this extra money when, you know, most artists, most brands, or most, you know, companies who are looking for our services are not really trying to break the bank, you know? So,
but there is an advantage for a Matt Alonzo, right? Because there's a network effect, right? So there's something a lot of their film directors, etc., or production studios don't have. A lot of them don't have that network, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's definitely there. You know, it's kind of interesting the way it works in terms of like, you know, that, like, which most people probably won't understand and might, you know, sound a little weird to hear this, but for a lot of the bigger videos, the budgets will be relatively small. And for me, I look at every job and I ask myself, okay, is this a creative job? Is this a job where it's going to, you know, push me creatively, or it's going to help me creatively as a director in terms of maybe getting more exposure? It's a great artist, a great opportunity, whatever that case may be. It's number one, or it's number two. It's a high paying job. I don't really love the idea. I don't love the artist. I'm not in love with the song or something. But the money is good. I'm going to do my best on this project, but I'm not going to fight the creative. If they want to do a certain idea or they want to go with a certain edit, I'm going to have to let my ego take a chill pill and just, because that happens, you know, you're over here fighting for edit changes for a job that you don't even like. And it's just because of the natural artist in you and that push, that the ego, I guess. So that's the way I break everything down like that. But so a lot of the big face jobs, you know, the known artist, the jobs won't be that much money in terms of budget wise. So, you know, you're really just kind of doing that for the look. And then you'll get these jobs from unknown artists, unsigned talent, or overseas. And that's when you get like huge budgets, you know, and because you've worked with these other artists and because you've built this brand and network. And so they want to work with you. And that's where a lot of the budget, like the money, comes into play. And it's just really interesting because you would think the opposite.
But it's a trade-off though, because like if you think about it like really analytically and critical, it's like, hey, this person has this major brand and that is a value they can bring attached to your value, and it just kind of snowballs.
Absolutely.
And somebody else who doesn't have that, they need to pay more to get that extra network.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's the way it kind of works. It's kind of like a feature on a record or whatever, you know? And it is, you know?
Yeah, you're right. I mean,
look at Cole Bennett. I mean, people pay that guy, you know, people will pay him $100,000 to get on his YouTube or whatever, you know? Probably more than that.
It's crazy.
And that's kind of what we were at Ski TV. And that's one, you know, a lot of things that I learned from Ski now looking back in, you know, hindsight, you know, things like this where we would shoot videos or shoot content for the exposure, for the, you know, the perception or just to help move the company forward.
Mm-hmm.
We wouldn't stretch ourselves too thin on this sort of stuff, but we would just do it for the look. Or
right, brand awareness.
But there'd be times where I didn't understand that and I'd be like, why is the budget? And so one of my agents, when I signed, after I left Ski, I had a music video rep and a producer, a production company, Tara Rezavi, she would calm me down. She'd be like, all right, ask yourself, is this a creative job? Do you want to go to bat for these certain edits? Do you want to do this? Because I'll do it with you. I'll do that. I'll go to bat for you, you know, but it's going to be XYZ, you know, or is this a job where you're making money? You're, you know, it's a $200,000 job. You're making 20 and song sucks. You know, you're like you're going to do your best, but like, do you need to fight everything on this, you know? And if they're already micromanaging, because obviously, unsigned artists spending a lot of money, they're going to want to know everything, you know, and be all up in the details. And so you have to be like, okay. And I think that really helped me not get frustrated, mm-hmm. you know, because that's where a lot of the frustration happens, you know?
Yeah, it's wild. It's like the micromanaging happens and like getting people to trust you to do your own work. That is the only part of the creative experience that I
sucks.
Fucking can't stand. It's like, dude, you pay for the expert, fucking let the expert do the expert work. Let's stop the fools.
But fairly early, like that type of client, they show themselves, at least for me, I know, like I already know, cause I kind of weed them out very simple way, is to basically ask them, like anybody who hits me on DM on Instagram, although it's, you know, it's kind of getting more common now, more, I guess, quote unquote, I wouldn't say professional, but more normal. Okay. Mm-hmm. Before it was like all the $10 rappers who were trying to hit you up. But now it's like, I get real artists hitting me up. But I always ask them, you know, I ask them to send me an email first off, but lately I've kind of stayed away from that so much. I ask them, what's your, send me your budget, the day you want to shoot, or, you know, the dates you're expecting to shoot in, when you would like to put out the project, and any creative ideas you may have. So budget, date to put out the video, so I know how long, you know, the editing time would be.
Right.
And any creative ideas. And if they can't tell me that, or they ask me, they hit their next message is like, whoa, how much is your rate? Or but anything other than exactly what I asked them, then I just happily, like, I just thankfully decline. Because I know at that point, well, you know, so-and-so can do it for $12 or like all that shit's going to come into play. Cause you already know. Cause if they're semi-professional, semi-real, they would just respect what you said and just be like, oh, even if they had $100, I have $100 for the budget. I want to shoot on Tuesday. And, you know, they'll at least be like that. And you understand like, okay, they respect you. They respect like, you know, what you're asking, and they're going to meet you there. And that's kind of a way to kind of weed them out. It's kind of like a test.
Right. Cause this bartering shit starts coming in there and it's like, hey man, I don't have time for
this. Yeah. Which is fine. Like, it doesn't, I mean, we can negotiate, but if you can't answer these questions and respect what I'm asking of you in terms of like, because obviously we understand that the most valuable commodity is time.
Yes.
Right? It's more valuable than money. And the way that you show that you respect not only your time, but other people's time is that you're responsive and you're very detailed in your interaction, especially if the other person is asking you to be detailed. And so if they can't respect that, then you know that they don't really know what they're doing, nor do they have respect for the time component. Maybe they don't know, but right. That doesn't need to be, it's not for you to explain that to them, you know?
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. I feel it. So like right now, what are you doing? Like you have, like, what are you working on? You have production company going on. What is it? Matt Alonzo?
Nah, man,
what are you doing right
that,
now?
Man, I couldn't do that. I couldn't do that because I said a lot of kids come and work with me. I had a lot of like, you know, and then they would just kind of start their own business, get a picture on set and then go start their own business, which obviously, you know, it's fine, but it just kind of got, I'm like, okay, well, I'm giving all my secrets to my company. This point is, I don't really understand it so much because nowadays nobody wants to work underneath somebody. No one wants to like work for a company. Everyone wants to have their own fucking YouTube, their own, you know, XYZ films with mm-hmm, two mm-hmm. followers. I'm just like, dude, in my mind, I'm like, you know how hard that is? You can just take all my, all you have to do is just show me that you are committed to whatever it is that we're doing here. And then I'll give you everything. Like, you can have all the videos. I don't even want to direct videos anymore. I'll grandfather you in. I'll produce them for you. I'll network, you know, with the commissioners. You know what I mean? I'll co-sign you. I'll help you. I'll help you in the editing. We'll do everything, right? I'll show you how to write treatment. They just can't. They can't do it. They just think, you know. So I can't start the production. It's just too much for me. I had one at a time, and then I would end up doing everything. They wouldn't. Some of my directors wouldn't want to do changes, and I'd be like, no, you have to do changes. This is a job for a client. It's not your own short film. You know, when you're young, you're like, I don't do this. Find the way it is. I'm like, oh, so. But right now, so what I decided to do, and I thought about it actually last year, was I always broke new artists, and I always kind of like built a lot of like brand identity and kind of.
You did.
Did a lot of you know, structure down, anything all the way down from like color schemes to fonts to all their visuals, album covers, things like that. Mm-hmm. So I was like, man, I would really like to see, you know, I would like to join on a team or join on an artist or something where I can kind of see it all the way through, you know, instead of just one and done or two and done.
So are you saying more like an artist development type of thing? Is that where we're
talking about? Artist management. Yeah, that's where I'm at right now. I'm managing an artist named Christian Gates, and you know, he's a huge TikTok singer. Like, he started singing on his TikTok when the pandemic started. Now he has 2.5 million, and we have about 600,000 Spotify, monthly Spotify listeners. And
wait, back that up. How many?
600,000 right now. 600,000.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah. No, he's awesome. He's amazing. He's 18 years old. He's an amazing talent. Mm-hmm. And you know, me having all these connections, having all these resources, obviously understanding content, branding, things like that. It's hand in hand. You know, it's and then having worked with so many producers and artists and writers and just met so many people that, and I've done so many favors for everybody. So, you know, not that I'm necessarily going to call, but you know.
Yeah. Yeah. I get it.
So, you know, that's just how the game works. But, and I'm like, wow, now I can actually give this to somebody who I can, you know, who will actually, it'll actually help them in a way that will help me as well. Like I can.
There's a mutual benefit.
And kind of, yeah, exactly. And so that to me just seemed more rewarding and more, because I do want to like pour my education, my knowledge, my resources into somebody. Like I want someone to share this with, like, you know what I mean? And that, for me anyways, that's what I worked so hard for, was, you know, to be able to present opportunities for others to have, you know. Now it's up to them to rise to the occasion, but I at least wanted to be able to present those opportunities. So and now I have opportunities to present, you know, young directors to direct his videos and things like that. And you know, he gets a lot of spins. We just did a remix with Atlantic Records, an official remix.
Okay.
So it was great. When, you know, we're talking with record labels, they already want to sign him to multi-million-dollar deals, but no, we're just building, you know? So it's a whole new lane for me. It's I'm learning and it's exciting.
I mean, that is interesting because this is kind of like the overlap. You know, I grew up in the entertainment industry, so I definitely understand it. But it's like, even when I was doing things with Moo Faces in general earlier on, we were doing a bunch of shit that was like unorthodox. And a lot of people in the industry, kind of what you guys were going through, there was a lot of pushback. People of old ways were like, hey, who the hell is this? What are you trying to do with the record label? What are you trying to do? What is Moo Faces TV, MTV, cease and desist, but then inviting us to Latin Los Primos Awards. And then it's just like, we're buddies, but then it's like, what the hell is going on? Right. It's like, it's interesting because it's like, you know, I remember early on, like what we would do is we started, you know, we would start managing our artists as well. We would try to manage the artists, and then we had a label. Then we would try to do slash deals with the major labels. Right. And within those times, I mean, shit got stolen. You know, I mean, I remember some music got stolen. Some people made some platinum shit off of it. And it's like, you gotta be careful, because it's like, industry is close. Like, it's just tight. Every time you talk to one person, they're friends with this person, and they're friends with another friend that you're friends with.
You gotta have your paperwork done.
Yeah, you do.
That's it.
And when you're earlier on, it's harder because.
I learned the hard way, bro. I had no paperwork at Ski TV. I mean, I had nothing, you know what I mean? I was on friendship. Like, I was like on everyone's friends, you know? I was 22, you know? So, I mean, I had paperwork, but my paperwork was done by the same person who did his. So right. It wasn't very beneficial for me. And I didn't realize that until way late, but it's my bad. It was my,
yeah, of course,
my responsibility to take care of that stuff. But yeah, you can't, like, and that's one thing I've learned now. It's like, I keep everybody at arm's reach. Until I have paperwork or like an NDA or something like that, I can't share anything creatively with anybody because it's gone. You know what I mean? It's no longer your idea at that point, you know, unless you have some sort of, you know, written agreement where it's like, hey, I'm showing you this, you can't take it. But even then they can take it and just put a slight twist to it.
Yep.
It's just the way it goes. So you just gotta be very cautious, you know?
That is a thing.
You know, having an 18-year-old artist, who, you know, who's, you know, he only started singing a year ago. He's amazing. The kid is freaking amazing. He writes his own records and everything, records them at home.
Wow.
But, you know, having a kid who's 18, obviously he knows everything at this point. This is where he's kind of at in his sort of development as a human being, mm-hmm. you know, which I understand. I was 18 once. I was a Mac. I knew everything, you know what I mean? It's kind of challenging there because I'm like, hey, you know. But I've learned to let go of the reins. I kind of do everything opposite of what I normally would do. And I'm like, okay, well, I'll let you learn. And then when you need my help or when you need somebody, you know, I'll catch you when you fall. But I can't prevent you from falling because then you're going to resent me for that and you're still going to fall anyways. So that's one thing that I've learned, which is very interesting.
So right now you've got you're doing production, but you're more mm-hmm. into artist management.
Yeah.
Do you have a label itself or have you started a label or is it artist management?
No, just an artist management. I mean, technically once you invest a dollar into your artist or you spend any money, then you're considered the label, you know, at least by, you know, music industry standards. So I think I'm going to go that route and just at least create a small like label production company where I at least have the LLC and kind of have opportunities to like maybe sign other artists or whatever. And then, you know, Christian will always have ownership of, you know, a certain percentage of that label, no matter, you know, whether there's 10, 15, 20 artists, which is him. So, and then also I was thinking, you know, one thing I wanted to try was give directors some of the percentage of the YouTube out, you know, videos and stuff like that, mm-hmm. because, you know, as a filmmaker, we've never had that. So like, I thought that would be cool, like something to at least be able to try and actually do on my end. Be like, all right, cool, you know, whatever, you know, you get points as if you're like a writer or producer for at least anything on the visual aspect of it, and just kind of incentivize there. Obviously still have a budget, but like just try something new and just, you know.
So are you doing like that, so, you know? But like as far as like when you're doing contracts with your artists, are you doing like 360 mm-hmm. deals or like how are you, you know, I don't know if you can leak
it's
any manage, of that
it's what's management your... deal I'm just doing management right now, you know. I have a couple of lawyers that fucking expensive, but they help me out. And I know a bunch of you know, managers, luckily, you know, a lot of my friends are managers, so I just have a little powwow with them and kind of have them look over things. But you know, for him, I just, yeah, we did a 360 on everything, anything that every entity that besides music, we start our own LLC for that, and that is basically its own business, and then we can discuss based on, you know, whoever's the idea or whatever. Like say we want to do a clothing line, or we want to do a hat, or we want to do shoes, or we want to do vinyl, or we want to do like a little book. Everything will be its own LLC, and then we discuss on the shared profit of that LLC and kind of keep it moving like that. I mean, there's a lot of opportunities to make money, and but that's not even on my mind right now. It's really just about developing him into the best version of himself, both as a musical artist as well as just a, you know, a young man. So
how'd you find
him? It's fun. I was actually doing a video for another unsigned artist, actually a really talented kid named Lex, and I was you know, that's where I got the idea with him. He was a new artist. He was he looked like a white boy with like blue eyes, blonde hair, but he's from Mexico City. He spoke fluent
Spanish, right?
Spanish, but his songs were very pop. Like he went from like Justin Bieber to like Bad Bunny, and it was
that's,
I was just
sick.
Blown away.
What? That's crazy. That's
yeah, sick. Crazy. But you know, and so I shot that video. I met him on set because they had a bunch of like they paid for a bunch of TikTokers to come out and be in the video, and dance and stuff, just so that they would share it. And he happened to be there. His old manager had reached out to me to shoot a video. And at that time, I was like, look, I'm not shooting. If you're a new artist, I'm not going to shoot your video unless I get percentage of you as an artist for the rest of your career.
Right.
I don't care.
Okay.
I just won't do it. I'll take 1%, 5%. Like, I just want some
skin, I want in some the game.
Sort of incentive.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, because I'm like, if I'm going to blow you up, or I'm going to, like, you know, put all this energy into your
brain. What's the kickback for you?
How? Yeah, absolutely. It has to be incentivized. I don't really care. I mean, unless you're paying me, you know, 500 grand. So then I was like, well, you know, how are you guys, you know, what's your situation looking like? Who do you guys have on the team? Who's running all your visual components of the management and artist side? And we met together and then, you know, I kind of just took the lead on that and he just kind of fell off. And then I sat down with him. I had a whole book and I had everything prepared and everything down to, like, you know, daily expenses, you know, down to everything, just so that we could go through and be very clear, like, what I was responsible for, what he was, and what we needed to know information wise. So it might have been overkill once again, just like the game thing. Like, I was just overly prepared, but I'm trying to, you know, I'm learning, you know what I mean? So,
right.
So that's where I met him, and that's kind of how it, and then we kind of went for like a 6-month like trial period, which I understand. I mean, why trust me? And why do I trust him? Like, we don't, you know, we have to kind of see how the system in the game works.
Right.
And so, you know, we've proven it to each other that we're, you know, in it to win. So,
yeah. I mean, so. I think what you're doing right now is cool and it's smarter. I think you've learned a lot from your previous, you know, wins and also failures, you know, pros and cons from that. And now you're trying to make more of a business out of it. So that way, you know, that doesn't happen to you like, you know, what happened previously, because you obviously have helped break a lot of artists. You helped make a lot of artists, you know, with your work and music videos, big fucking hits.
But I didn't understand it at that point, but how big, like, what exactly I was doing, right? Like, I looked at it as just a filmmaker. I looked at it as just that, you know, just that little video was, you know, I mean, if anything, I was in it more for the gratification of the audience, like more of the likes and things like that. And I talk about this in other interviews where I kind of got lost in that. Well, it was much easier to, you know, get those accolades and feel like you're doing something just based off of, you know, a couple of fucking harps. Yeah. So, you know, like, I mean, it's a different lane, and it's also like, I want to take a step back from actually always having to work. It's not a product, you know what I mean? And like, I've tried to make products and stuff like that, but I don't know, it's not really in me. I like to help people like directly, or I did like a masterclass. That was awesome. You know, I like to.
What was that masterclass about?
It was called the Film League. It was just one that I developed. I'd done one for Aperture, blew up Aperture Lighting. They were like two followers when I did a masterclass for them. And I did a couple other like seminar type things.
Mm-hmm.
And I really enjoyed those. So my buddy, Jonathan Olivio, he actually moved out from Texas one night after seeing my behind the scenes. He was like, yo,
wow,
I could be this kid. And then he packed up his family, drove to LA to live. But he told me like, yo, man, he was doing a lot of these master classes for these like big, business people. Mm-hmm. And he was like, you have to do this. This was like years. And so eventually, finally, I'm like, all right, how do we do this? Let's do this thing. And so I made the Film League. I developed the Film League. And, you know, we had about 300 kids out there. And it was just, an event I put together at Studio 60, one of the big locations that out here in LA. And I had a bunch of brands there, Red, Lighting Company, Lupo, Matthews. It was awesome. It was awesome. And we just went through everything from like how to write treatments, how to work with clients, how to, you know, edit, shooting, shutter speeds, frame rates, and then I did a Q&A for a couple hours, and I was that's much more rewarding to me than putting together, like, you know, having these products or something like that. I'm just not, my business brain just I'm just not a businessman, I'm an artist, you know. So
right, so you feel more like a creative, you feel more like I'm the creative, I really don't want to deal with much of that business. But now you've had to put yourself on a business hat on now.
Yeah, and when I can do it for somebody else, to be honest, it may be some sort of a weird psychology thing, you know what I mean? Like, but, you know, for Christian, I don't mind being the business hat for him. I'm very, like, analytical in the business and try to put together the products, and I don't mind doing the work there. But when it comes to, like, me, like, and being like, okay, let me deconstruct this project that I just did. Let me put it together in a pack that I can sell, and then put a promo for it up, and then do like a tutorial for YouTube and sell it. I just don't have the oomph, you know, like it just doesn't, I can make the video and spend 50, 70 hours on this amazing edit.
Right.
And then to like, you know, like I'm just not, I just don't have, now if somebody could come in and do that for me, that would be very beneficial, but I just don't have that. You know, I've tried a couple of times and I just like, I can't even do YouTube videos, you know? So I'm just not, you know, I try, man.
Yeah. I know exactly what you're saying, man. And that is interesting. And it was just, this is totally off place, but it's a lot of people don't know about, you know, Mexico City has, there's a lot of people with blue eyes and stuff like that. Yeah, and there's a lot of people.
Yeah, no, it tripped me out, bro. And this kid's really talented. Maybe, you know, I hope he goes on to do great things, you know. His name's Lex Lydia. I actually shot his video. The video is actually pretty cool. So you can find that actually on my YouTube page. Mm-hmm. It's pretty cool. And you know, he's an awesome talent, super talented kid. Yeah, once I found Christian and this started kind of clicking, mm-hmm. I didn't even explore that other, you know, explore it that further. So
that's crazy.
Cause like, I'm just trying to learn that, you know, like what I'm doing and kind of what I need to do before I bring anybody else into the mix, you know?
Yeah. So right now, what you have,
father.
Yeah, you gotta be that sometimes. Like right. No, So right now what you're doing is you're going to be, are you trying to do like slash deals with the record labels, or you just want to do separate, just I'm going to be the artist management? Cause slash deals are usually the better, because if you do like a
what
slash
is that?
Deal. Oh, so let me
like
tell
single?
You. So slash deal is, I'm going to let the secrets out cause I don't give a fuck.
Woo.
So slash deals are basically like this, you know, basically what it is. And, let's say you create a label, and this is what I was doing earlier with Moveface's, in general. So I had Moveface's records and I would do events, and then I also had the TV and the social network and some other little mm-hmm. small micro things, but I was doing too much shit at once. That was before it needed to be done. Learn from that shit. But anyways, point taken. So what you do is, right, and you have the networking connections. You're shooting the music videos and stuff like that. You know how to do that. Awesome, great. That is a part of the, you know, artist development. But if you actually form a label of your own, and then yep. go to Interscope and have these artists, right? You can ask them to do a slash deal, kind of like Cherry Tree Records was with Interscope.
Yep.
Right.
Yep.
So that's a slash deal right there. And so what they do is they can.
Oh yeah, just like Top Dog. I mean, Aftermath. I mean, all of those, right?
Yeah. So they just give you the check, and you do whatever you want to do.
Got you. That's that's like kind of what, you know, a couple of my manager friends, you know, BYI Entertainment, who does, you know, he's a Latin. He does Omar Cruz and a couple other Latin. That's mm-hmm. that's what he does. He managed the clips, and he got all the budget for the clips. Like they just gave him the check, and he did everything. And he was essentially like a record label under the record label, right? Cherry Tree.
Yep.
Same thing. Normally that's who you work with. It's like Interscope's such a big company. At least the bigger record labels are so big that they fund the other ones, right? That's definitely something. You know, I'm trying not to bite off more than I can chew. But I mean, I actually would love to hear more off air and like, and kind of pick your brain a little bit on this. Cause I'm learning.
Totally,
you know what
down.
I mean? And at this point in my career, I have no problem asking, you know what I mean? And if there's anything I can be in, of service and help, give as well as take, but I have no problem asking. Obviously early in my career, I just didn't ask for help at all. Maybe because one, I thought I knew everything, and two, obviously my ego is just
same here.
They're not gonna help me. But you learn, you know what I mean. And now I have no problem. I have no problem. Just people like, nah, bro. I'm not giving, you know, whatever. I have no problem, you know. So I would love to pick your brain, and you know, because I'm still trying to figure out what it is I'm doing. You know what I mean? I know he's a pop artist. I need a major record label to push him to the next stratosphere. You know, we're not there yet, but you know. But definitely.
Yeah. I mean, you know, if you look at it like this, Matt, it's like basically some of the things that you're doing is similar to a Scooter Braun, but Scooter Braun, mm-hmm. you know, there was many others before that who did this similar type of structure. It's just like, mm-hmm. I don't think Scooter actually did hit. I don't think he actually did a label himself. I think he just did yeah, himself as artist right, management. What'd you yeah. say?
Yeah. I think it was it just artist. What was his company called? It was,
I forgot what it was called.
They just sold it. They just sold for like
tons of money. It was
yeah, right.
I think it was like a, but I thought it was like a management company. It wasn't actually a label.
I think it is. Yeah, I think it is. But it's kind of like a middle thing, I guess.
Right, because it wasn't like full on like we have a label.
But I think he was like writing records as well. Like he had writers that were probably writing for other people, and then I think probably producers and stuff. I don't know exactly how he had.
But he was smart, dude. Scooter started working. You know, my uncle used to work with him before he was Scooter Braun. And he was trying again, and he was just doing, you know, parties. And, you know, he was just learning from Jermaine and all these other people like that. And he was smart and meticulous about it. He was humble to everybody that was over him. And, oh, yeah, thank you, man. I'm so humble. And then he just got what he needed to get. And then once he got what he got, he fucking used that shit and leveraged it. And he used Justin Bieber's one of his little things to catapult. Now he's just like, yeah, I'm busy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he's like, you're not calling anybody. He's like, I don't talk to nobody on the phone. I don't even care. You gotta talk to my assistants, even see if I'm available.
And that
even keep you on hold.
Yeah, and that shit's crazy though. I mean, you could be boys with him or whatever it may be, or work with different people like that. I just think like you should always stay humble as you possibly can.
Absolutely.
Because you just don't ever know.
You never know. You know what I mean? You never know. And like, there's been several times in my career, I'm you know, not humble because I'm very appreciative. I'm very like, you know, empathetic. And I do think a lot about others, but sometimes I'm overwhelmed with responsibilities and I'll be, like you said, you know, doing just my hands in too many pots. I'm editing two videos. I'm writing a treatment for another three. I'm going to a meeting. I'm shooting tomorrow. You know what I mean? And so when I meet somebody, it's not that I'm rude or anything. I'm just not present. Like I talked a little bit about earlier, I'm just not present. Sometimes I'm like, fuck this dude, man.
Hell yeah.
But thankfully, like, I think their intuition, you know, I have enough where, you know, my personality is just kind of, you know, I know I'm the shit, but at the same time, I think everyone else is the shit at their own thing as well. Like, I don't, you know, I can build my tower without affecting your tower. You know what I mean? So I'm very respectful and humble, like, to other people and very happy to be in their presence and work in collaboration. But sometimes I'm just not there. And so that I try to be more like, you know, present so that
coherent and stuff like that and present in the moment. Yeah.
Yeah, because I mean, that sort of perception or that sort of first interaction is, you know, they might just think, wow, he's a dick. Like he didn't even look at me in the eye. But I'm really, really, I'm thinking about, man, do we have a dolly for that shot? Like, or whatever, right?
Yeah, I mean, but could it be also at the same time as like you're doing so fucking much that you really just
absolutely.
Have that time to, you know, to think and
yeah, yourself. Which is good too. You know, like I learned a little bit from Ski. The one thing that Ski was freaking amazing at was that he would give you either 30 seconds or 2 minutes of his time, his direct time, his eye contact, his handshake, and then he was gone. But that 2 minutes or 30 seconds, he was all yours. And you felt like the most important person to him. Mm-hmm. And that goes such a long way as opposed to like, all right, hey, nice to meet you. And like, you know, so that was one thing I looking back in hindsight that I definitely.
Yeah, because you guys were doing Karma Loop. You guys had all kinds of stuff you guys were doing it back in the day.
We signed to Karma Loop. So we were estimated at 100 million. So we signed to Karma Loop. They bought 10% of us for 10 million.
Shit.
So
that was not a bad deal.
We did the first clickable video ever, which, so if you, the Ice Cube video, you could watch it. And then any of the clothes they were wearing were clothes from their website. And so you could click on anything, watch the glasses. Obviously, you couldn't click on the cars or anything, or the girls. They weren't up for sale. But any of the clothes or accessories, they would just go directly into your shopping cart. And it was too ahead of its time.
Yeah, it definitely was. So what would you give other, you know, directors, filmmakers? I know you've said this shit a lot, but what kind of advice would you give them?
I mean, my advice is that I think, you know, from my perspective, a little different than others, like other people. You know, I look at it in my circumstances, what I did with Ski, right? So I kind of devoted my time, my life to Ski TV and Ski. And by doing that, I gained access to all networking and networks and contacts that he had, right. That I would never have the you know, not never, I mean, they wouldn't have been
so fast
to me
the
way that they were, but that came with the trade-off of doing the whether it's free work or you're doing, you know, committing to another company or committing to something other than Matalongo Films and giving it full effort, and that's what the trade-off was. And that to me is what I think filmmakers should take a look at that, or just creatives in general should just take a look at possibly, you know, working under somebody or working for a company to, you know, you can still think about yourself in terms of the long run, mm-hmm. but if you put in a few years with, you know, a company and devote yourself to that, they're going to give you endless possibilities. I mean, you can leave that opportunity and have a handful of contacts and do your own thing. Mm-hmm. But while you're there, you got to devote yourself instead of like trying to like pull clients away or like, I can do this on the side. That happens, like all that type of, no, I mean, it just does though, you know?
Oh, I know.
And it's crazy to me, but like, at the same time, I remember being there. Like I remember being with Ski and then being like, oh no, I can do the video. And then Ski telling me, or you know, the other owner, like, oh, well, you can't do that. Like, I'm like, wait, why? Cause like,
it's a conflict of fucking interest.
And then I, you know, yeah, of course. But you know, I'm 22. I don't know anything.
Yeah. Even my business partners did the same shit. I know exactly what you're talking about.
Dude, it happens all the time. But if, and so what incentive does that company have to, you know, like they're not going to, I mean, obviously they're probably going to get you out of it pretty quickly, but you know, they're not going to, what would be their purpose to give you access to all their clients if you're just going to go and sidebar them, you know? So, but if you're able to show that you're committed to at least, you know, to them for whatever amount of time, I don't think many companies think you're going to be there forever, but
right.
You know, you're going to be presented with so many more opportunities than you are if you try to do it by yourself with your YouTube channel or with your website that gets no traffic and your XYZ films and you're under, you know, you're starting from, you know, like it doesn't make any sense to me. You know what I mean? And it's just with so much competition out here. So everybody has a red camera, everyone has a production company. It's like, now you're just another one of those get in line. You know what I mean? You're going to be fighting over jobs where realistically you should be fighting over contacts,
right?
Not necessarily what's going to help you tomorrow. You know, because there were several years of my career where, from a money standpoint, from a outsider looking in, I didn't have much, and it was a building time. But there's a lot of time like that, you know. So I think people don't see that on Instagram and don't see that on social media, so they think it's like it's either success or failure, you know. And it's like, no, they're gonna be failure as far as like up ramen or whatever, but you're shooting big videos, you're working with big brands, but like, you know, because it's all going towards something. But it makes no sense to me personally to be a 19, 22, 23 year old kid out here with your own film company, with one follower and a $50,000 camera that you owe money on. And I don't feel it sets yourself up for success. So just take a look at, you know, what may be the best avenue. And yeah, you're gonna have to calm down your ego a little bit, but you could be the best for that company. And that company, as long as you get with a good one and you use your intuition about who you should work for, that company is gonna grant you more than just a salary.
Sick. One last question I definitely wanted to dig into with you is when you're actually on the set, you know, mm-hmm. and you have your clients, you know, and then you have, you know, your team, has there been any type of situations where you've had in the past to where it's been like a situation, and how did you keep it
like
cool?
What?
Like, for example, like, you know, sometimes talent doesn't like your fucking DP or somebody else on set, and they just pissed them off in some way. You never had any situation like that? I have some situations.
We have, but like, you know,
how do you mitigate that?
Usually my producers would handle that, like stuff like that. But like, I mean, because like, I kept a really tight like ship. You know what I mean? And as long as like you're professional, all your crew's gonna be professional. Like they kind of, you're the leader. So like, if you're out, you know, you gotta, you know, my director's name is XYZ or something, and like I'm a rapper, but like a video director, and I don't really know what I'm doing. Then your crew's gonna be all over the place. You know what I mean? And that happens a lot. I see it. But you know, like I've never had that necessarily happen. I mean, I've had instances where the artist didn't like what the setup looked like, or the scene, or the girls,
right?
You know, in the game video, stuff like that. Which after your first like a few of them, you have to like, because at first you're like, whoa, what do you mean? Like, you think the project's yours, but you, as you mature, I think, I mean, something you have to, you know, another tip would be just to understand that you're doing a work of service for somebody else. Like, it's actually their project, not yours.
Right.
If you want to use a freaking jib arm and they don't like the jib arm, okay, like, you know what I mean? Like, it's not your, you know, do your own films and stuff like that, you know what I mean? And that kind of helped me there, you know what I mean? But yeah, there have been times where I'm like, nah, we're going with this or whatever. And then I'm like, I'm walking off. nah, I never did.
I mean,
maybe I think I did probably.
I think like there's a difference, like, you know, like there's guys like Tyler Perry who have like these big ass production companies where somebody can't come in and so easily copy him or just leave him because he has this like lockdown on his whole like scene. You know what I mean? Like, he's just built this brand where it's just like, are people just leaving him when you get to that level, or is that not true? Or is that true? Like, what?
I think.
How do you think?
Well, if they do leave, they're probably not. I mean, leaving enough to come with him, right? So it doesn't really matter. And then anybody who, like, as people begin to like kind of fall off, or you know, you have some people come and go, then you get as a company or as a business or as a creator, you get more weary or more. You have a much stricter like process to weed people out, and you're very cautious about who you let in and who you give certain secrets to, or I guess, you know, expose certain information to, you know, right? And so, you know, those people who you do give your secrets or you show a lot to, you know, they're trusted people. They're people who are going to be ingrained and enmeshed in your sort of business. And I think he probably has, you know, a top 10 or 5 or, you know, 15 people who kind of run the ins and outs of it, and they kind of know. But anybody who's probably lower than that probably doesn't get exposed to very much. And so if they do leave, they're not taking very much with them, you know? But also, like, you know, you have to incentivize workers as well. Like, you know what I mean? And I know that as a worker, like, so,
right.
You know, but, so you have to give them, you know, at least be upfront about what it is that you can offer, what it is that you see, and just not kind of run through them, which a lot of production companies do. But I think people, I just think right now it's just such a selfish individual sort of career path, which it's not. It's a very team oriented business. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. To actually shoot a movie or to shoot a real project, any of the videos that are your favorite music videos or your favorite commercials or your favorite movies, those had a big, big crew that helped put those together. I mean, 30 plus people, if not 50, 100, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so if you look at it from that aspect, why would you have just one person or two people trying to run a company? You know what I mean? Trying to do the same thing. You're trying to emulate something that, I don't know. I hope it gets back to that. But I just think with, you know, having social media, yeah, you have those Cole Bennett's. You have those one or two people who are able to create their own lane. But there's also, you know, a million people who don't, you know? So I guess everybody's just hoping to win the lotto and be the luck of the draw. I wish more people would just, at least for a couple of years, just go work for a company and devote their time to it. And I don't know. We should ask Tyler Perry if how often his. But I've talked to a lot of companies, and they can't keep, you know, interns. Or, I mean, I did 4 internships, and I was living in Ventura. I drove 45 minutes every single day,
mm-hmm.
and I would edit and do stuff or shoot for free. And I mean, because it's an internship, you don't get paid for internships, you know,
right.
At least not back then. But I was, you know, I got contacts, I got experience.
Right.
It was very beneficial for me. At least I had the mindset it was beneficial for me. Nowadays, I have an intern come and he's like, "Oh, when do I get my check?" And I'm like, no, it doesn't work like that. What, dude?
Where's
what?
My money,
I'm
bitch?
Put this on Reddit, man.
What?
I'm gonna put this on Reddit. Work wow. for free. He made me internship for free. I'm just wow. kidding. But like, I do see people like that, you know.
That is bananas. So, I couldn't. Yeah, that. Yeah, I could see that, man. Everybody's in this entitlement.
But people are like, yeah, of course. And then everyone's like, dude, don't work for free. It's like, well, how? Then you could be the best at what you do, but like, I'm not going to hire you because I've never worked with you. I've never seen any of your work. You don't have anything that, you know. Even if just because you have a camera, just because you have this, that doesn't matter to me. I don't care. Right. I can go call Red. I can call Red and get their brand new camera for free. Like, I don't, you know. So it's just. But instead of, I've had a lot of kids who've been able to come on my set who were like, hey, I have a camera, I have all this stuff, but I just can't get exposure, or I can't get onto sets. You know, I'll come for free, or I'll come for just pay my gas or whatever. And I'm like, all right, cool. Let's get an opportunity. And those mm-hmm. those guys and girls go on to now a lot of them are, you know, running full, you know, full schedules in whatever field that they're doing. And so, you know, it definitely helps. You know what I mean? I've done it. I still do it. I'll still do free or you know, sometimes I'll just grab a camera and go to a studio with an artist or go film a little thing for a brand or whatever, because I know that it's going to, as long as I feel like it's going to make sense and I have some sort of plan for it, then I have no problem doing it. And I just wish more people would understand that long game.
And how would that, and like another question I'd want to ask is like, how have you been doing things during the pandemic? Like how has that been?
I've been out here popping, bro.
You still been like still fucking, you know, killing it, recording shit during the pandemic?
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, like, so what I did during this was, actually I did like shit, probably like 10 videos. All of them independent though. I didn't do anything through a record label. I got contacted a lot, but I was like, dude, there's no way I'm wearing a hazmat suit and fucking getting tested 10 times. And like, I'm like, dude, and it's like all for show. And I'm just like,
it just doesn't even make any sense to me. Cause like, you know, you gotta go to rehearsals and you guys are fucking butt close together. No one's wearing masks. And then you're on set and you're in a hazmat suit and shit. I just, for me, it just took all the fun out of it. I just had no desire to do that. So I would just do small projects, you know, $5,000-$10,000, grab my camera. I've been very lucky and fortunate to get, you know, a lot of lighting sent to me and other products. So I just take what I have and go make something, you know, and it's kind of back to like guerrilla where you're, I mean, it's cool because you know, it's a little more creative, a little less, you know, like detail oriented, but, right. You know, you can make more money too. I mean, sometimes like on a big job, you might spend all your money on a big job, whereas a little job, you're grabbing the resources that you do have, you're going to a friend's location and, you know, you're able to pay your crew and put a lot of money into your pocket. So I just kind of been taking advantage of whatever opportunity present themselves. And then as long as I feel comfortable, like, you know, I have I shot a video the other day with just me and one other person, two person crew. I used 5 lights. I did 4 setups and the video looks awesome, you know? So I don't know. I'm just using more like of my, you know, my knowledge of like what I actually need. I don't need these huge crews and production, like all this stuff. If that's not what I'm doing. Right.
Right.
Like,
I mean, you've also worked with like guys like also, I think you work with Chris Brown too.
Yeah, of course.
Tiger.
Oh yeah. I mean, I've known Tiger since the day I moved here. I know Tiger, Kendrick, and Schoolboy Q. Those are like my homies.
In Get out of here. You know where I know Tiger from? I know Tiger from the Northridge fucking mall, walking around saying he was going to be a rapper. And
because he used to live out there, huh?
Yeah.
It was. That's when he was on that show.
That shit was hilarious. He would walk through the mall, try to be like, he was dressed like, it was actually at the time, it was fucking funny. Everybody would laugh in Northridge Mall because you see him walk through and it's like, dude, I'm like, who's that fucking dude? And there's like, oh, that's fucking Tiger.
That must have been 2006?
Oh, no. It was like 2000 and at least 2010, possibly, I think. He wasn't big then. I think it was like 2000.
Because I met him 2007, 2008. That's when I was filming him. And then I went to the Lil Wayne set at the Maloof's house. Then I met him, Kendrick.
Oh, the fucking Maloof's. Malone,
all those guys. And then I came back and then like, you know, Kendrick was K-Dot at the time. I actually was there when he changed his name. The day he changed his name, we filmed it. But we were shooting videos for him, Tyga, Gata. Gata's actually now he's on what's that one white rapper with the curly hair? He has a company.
Oh, I know exactly what you're talking about. Not Malone. It was I know his fucking name, dude. He's got the curly brown hair.
Like the jokester, did that video where he showed up and he's like, "Hey, I need to shoot a video for free. Can we use your house? Can we use your?"
Wait, that's not Machine Gun Kelly.
No, MGK. No. He's like a white rapper with curly hair, like tall, like real skinny dude, kind of funny rapper. He has a show now on like a big show on Comedy Central and Gata, which was Tyga's like right hand man. With GED when they had getting every dollar or whatever. It was like the record label, but he's now the co-star of the show. He blew up.
I don't know. I just know like in fucking 2009 era to 2011.
He was horrible. I mean, his raps were horrible. I have all these videos that I shot on mini DVE, like tatted like a cholo, all these things. I was shooting all his stuff back then.
That's crazy. So, yeah, because he would just walk through the mall all the fucking time. Everybody was like, dude, there's that fucking guy who thinks he's a rapper.
He was signed to Pete Wines, which was the Cadence. He was signed to Gym Class Heroes. He signed to Young Money with Wayne.
That was when he got big. Chain on. Yeah.
So he had that, and then he was signed to Cash Money, Universal. So he was signed to like 10 labels. So when he did his first album... All that money had, you know, everyone takes their percentage. So by the time it got to him and Kendrick, Kendrick was the same way. Kendrick was on Top Dog, Aftermath, GED, and then Interscope, Geffen. And there's articles Jamie about Abby. All that stuff too. It's crazy though. It's crazy to look back on that. But yeah, I remember Tyga. I worked with Tyga.
It's a fucking small ass world though. How everybody is like, seen so many people not somewhere, and the next minute they're somewhere or work with this person. They weren't there, and now they're somebody big, and everybody's like, oh, that person's like famous.
It's crazy. It's really crazy. I mean, a lot of the artists that I've worked with are, you know, have gone on to do are huge and blow up. Like,
dude, I mean, like even awesome. Like even my grandpa, he was on RCA, and he would session and write songs and stuff like that with Sly and Family Stone and things like that, and. You know, Larry Graham would teach my dad sometimes like some riffs on bass and things like that when they would go on tour and things like that. And they also had the same manager. But his brother, Larry, had a brother, and his brother is actually Drake's father. And that's how small the fucking world
is. Dude who's always in the club, he's always in the club.
But his brother was fucking making great music. You know, he was already famous. A lot of people don't know that. But Larry Graham is Drake's uncle, who was also famous in the 70s, who, you know, created slap bass, which is why you see, you know, Flea, you see fucking Korn, all these other people that, you know, gravitated toward that style.
Tiny, right? It's
so
a
very, innovation, it's a very small world. Innovation came from the fucking family. He didn't start from the total bottom. He has some solid fucking
people behind. Bro, started from the bottom. Bro, he's really grossy, bro. I mean, it's all once you kind of understand. Like, what, I brought my dad to a lot of I brought my parents to a lot of videos, and they were kind of in shock because they're like, "Wait, why are they taking the chains off of him? Where are all the clothes going? Why are we leaving the house?" And I'm like, "All this is rented. This is all fake. This is all facade. Everything is just not really what it seems." Everyone's connected. It's all just, you know.
It's a really small fucking world. But when you drive off with your real shit, everybody's surprised. Like, oh man, that's really his. Ooh.
Sometimes, yeah. That's very rare. You know what I mean?
These are the facts. Rare. I drive off my real shit though. But yeah, Matt, it was great having you fucking on. I know we're gonna.
Oh, real quick, I found the artist. Little Dicky is who I was talking about. He has his own show, and now. Now Tyga's like a right-hand man. He's like kind of like his hype man and his like artist that was signed to him. They're like best friends. I think they had a falling out, but I met him like 2007 with Tyga. And so we were always together and then I didn't hear from him for like 10 years. And then all of a sudden he popped up on Comedy Central, I think, or now he's.
But that's what happens to some of us though, man. We'll disappear for a while. We're working in the dirt. You know, we're doing a little thing.
And I like what you said. I like what you said earlier about just being humble to, you know, around everybody and just, And not so much because, I mean, if you really have to think about it in this way, just because you don't know who anybody is or who anybody will be. So always just respect everybody. I mean, I guess that's like, if you have to go there, but you should just be a good person and just kind of be humble anyways. But, you'd be very surprised, like, because most people who are in, like, if you're out in LA and you're out kind of just mingling and stuff, most people who are doing something are actually working. They're not talking about their work. They're not the ones talking like, yeah, I'm signed artist, blah, blah, blah. That person's doing nothing.
These are
like,
the facts.
I'm a filmmaker, but it's like, nah, I don't even listen because I don't say anything. But then you'll meet them and maybe you're rude to that guy or maybe you're really nice. Like, I've been really nice to people and just kind of like, oh, hey, or bought him a beer or whatever, right? And then they're like, oh, I'm the head of Netflix or whatever. And you're just like, oh, cool. And then that's just what starts the relationship.
So you're a fucking smart guy and you're getting it. And that's one thing that when I show up on anything, I don't drop nothing. I don't say anybody. I know anybody. I just like, I'd be like, hey, what are you doing, man? I was like, oh, I'm just a dude with a camera.
Yep.
Okay.
And then
they start fucking saying some other shit. I'm like, okay, cool.
That's what he knows, you know? And I don't give it no mind.
Yeah.
But I realized that pretty fairly quickly is that, like, because I'm working all the time. Last thing I want to do is fucking go out and talk about what I just spent 90 hours on. I'm just like, yeah, I want to do anything or talk about anything other than that. And obviously, if anybody else is working the way that you are, they want the same. And they just want to be normal for that short amount of time. And so, like, the more, you know, non-industry you can be, the more somebody who's in the industry is going to really, like, gravitate to that and soak that
in. I mean, you gotta think of it this way and this way. It's like somebody who's been into this and you've seen this, you know this, and this is nothing anymore. Yeah. And when you're awoke, you realize this, a lot of the shit's bullshit and smokes and mirrors, and it really doesn't mean anything. Oh, yeah. And you're just humble and you're ready to work and you just want to. You just want to hang with people. You want to have a good time, man. It's not that serious, man. We all going to die and turn to dirt.
Hey, but there's some people, like, you know, some filmmakers who think we're saving the world. And I'm just like, yo, bro, it's not rocket science. It's not, you know, we're not saving lives. Like, well, you know, because of the, and I'm just like, dude, it's not poetic. It's not, I mean, all right, whatever. My responsibility, you know what I mean?
Nah, I totally get it, man. But let's definitely keep in contact. And I'm always keeping up with what you're doing. Always, you know, always got positive support for what you're doing and what you're going on. Because
I appreciate you having me on here, man. And I'm excited to see where this thing goes.
Oh yeah. We're always going places, man. There's a lot.
I know, always.
We always fall. We fail. We fuck up. We learn. We grow. We switch. And
that's life.
Shit bangs. And some things don't. Some things do. And
That's it.
You gotta keep.
But
on
you have
fighting.
To. You have to be. You have to be willing to fail to succeed. I mean, if you're not willing to fail, then you're never gonna try anything, and you're never gonna succeed. You're never gonna fail either. Because you're never gonna. Because you're never gonna try anything. You know what I mean? And I think a lot of people are too scared of scared of failure. But failure is where you actually learn. When you lose a game, you learn what you need to do to win the game. When you win the game, you don't really learn too much. You just go out and take your jersey off and take a shower, right? So. And then you get complacent and stuff like that. So,
But if you look at it this way, when you pass away, you don't want to have that regret that I didn't fucking try, no matter what.
Absolutely, that's number one. I mean, that should be the absolute. I mean, it's worth a shot, right?
What other shot do you fucking have?
That's what I'm saying. It's all the way down to like, yo, if you see a girl that you're like, oh, I want to get this girl's number. Go ask her. Like, she says no, great. You're in the same position you were 5 minutes ago, but at least you can die. In peace.
There you go. But sometimes it's fucking even deeper than that, because sometimes it's really it's all about you can be analytical about it, because it's just like, you know, is it the time or the place? And sometimes that person could say yes sometimes, and then like later they say fucking
what if you never see him again?
Those are the fucking.
But see, like you said, like you gotta just take your shot while you have it. You know what I mean? And if it's right, it's right. If it's not, it's not. I mean, yeah, you don't just like, she's talking and having a group meeting. Just excuse me. Actually, you might be able to do that. You know, like, as long as you're tall and you have a full head of hair, maybe. You're
Hey, Rogan has no fucking hair, man. He's still
I got jokes. And he's tiny. He's tiny, too.
Yeah, he's really tiny. He's just
but he's a multi-millionaire.
Now.
money. After
he failed so many times with little things, and now he's like the biggest shit in the world. Now he loves it.
Yeah, I love Rogan.
Kisses.
I love Bill Burr. Bill Burr is one of my favorite
dudes. Yeah, my friend Christine was a publicist. She actually was when I was down in LA like last weekend, she did a fucking show with Bill Burr, and they were all backstage just jamming it up and having a good time.
I love him.
Yeah, he's hella funny, right? There's some good ass people out there doing some good ass podcasts.
Amazing.
Yeah. Amazing. I don't know, man. It's interesting stuff, man. I love it.
Absolutely.
But
I appreciate your insight though, man. I definitely want to explore further about your knowledge of all the music industry, because that is very.
I know a lot about a lot of industries. The thing about me is I know a lot about the tech industry, in depth, deep in depth, and I know a lot about the music industry.
What you got going on? Let me ask you a question.
Oh shit, we're gonna ask me a question.
Roles reversed.
No, for me, I think like, you know, me, I'm always, you know, I moved from, you know, the whole LA area after, you know, working hard and busting my ass and building a bunch of things like that. And I wanted just to take a break from it, because I just got tired of all the bullshit. And I was just like, you know, there was a lot of blockers for the way that I saw things and how I wanted to do things with the entertainment industry and technology. And so I just moved up to Silicon Valley and took a fucking break and said, hey, I want to be closer to more of the tech in general, and kind of learn what the bigger tech companies were doing before I launch out and build a bunch of shit. So that's what I did. I moved up here, and your internet is fucking disabled again, but I'll keep on talking to you.
Damn.
But so I mean, pretty much that's what I did. And I started coming up here, and fucking I'd work with some companies like Lyft, and you know, earlier on when they were trying to differentiate themselves from Uber at the time, and build out their growth system, and I left, and later they fucking sold it for billions when they went public.
Crazy, right?
Really fucking crazy, but you didn't know at the time, right? And then I started building shit for Facebook, and then I started building shit for LinkedIn, and that's kind of what I've been doing for the last couple of years. I took a kind of, you know, let me learn what's going on in these bigger systems behind the scenes, so that way it can also reinforce some of my future decisions and things that I've already known.
That's great.
And so that's what I pretty much did, you know? And now I just said, hey, you know what? People are like, hey, you know a bunch of shit. Why don't you start a fucking podcast? And I was like,
absolutely.
Yeah, I don't want to fucking be in the front. I don't want to be like there. I don't want to be that guy. I don't want to be famous. I don't want to be in the screen. I just kind of want to pull back, because prior, I mean, you probably don't know this, but I was also in a boy band. I was in a boy band. We were doing 10,000, show, a pop, you know, we were doing fucking, you know, bars, clubs. We opened up.
Wait,
one time.
What was the band called? I looked this up.
You're going to try to do me like that, dude.
All right. Put it in the chat.
I'll put it in the chat, dude. But, I try to keep it hard on like smothering that shit down and not having it open. I enjoyed being behind the scenes, and I kind of got bored of being in the front.
Wait, you were a singer?
Yeah, a dude. Rapper? What? Dude, I was like a fucking singer. Dude, I play like six different instruments. I play guitar, bass, wow, drums.
Hell yeah. Shit like that. That's cool. I mean, I always wanted to be a musician.
Yeah, I think I did too, man. And I still am. But I think it's just like, I didn't like the weird shit that hustle, happened on hustle. The stage. And then I found myself fucking drinking something before I went on, you know, the fucking stage to relax. Because you're like fucking all these people out there and you're...
Of course.
It felt overwhelming. I got anxiety. And then people, your friends started not liking you when you think that they should. You know, it just got really weird. Shit That's got tough. Weird, you know? And I just kind of wanted to back out of it. And that was when I kind of said, you know what? I kind of want to, I want to... be behind the scenes. And I had a dream, man. I had a fucking dream, man. I literally had a dream.
Damn, Martin Luther.
I had a fucking dream, dude. I fucking had a dream that I was building a fucking entertainment company in tech, and that I was going to build some shit. Wow. And then I was like, fuck. Hell yeah. I fucking moved out to Los Angeles with three friends and we started fucking doing it. And fucking needless to say, here I am. And I did do some of those things as well. And I'm still doing some of those things. And it's kind of all connected. And there was no plan. Like, literally, we moved out here with credit cards. I didn't drop any names, no affiliations. I didn't contact anybody. I'm just trying to do some stuff. And, you know, that was kind of like the thing. And I think where you were at that time, I think we were all a part of some things that were now we see kind of in the future. Some of it's kind of come in fruition, but it wasn't quite there. And it's still not quite there.
Yeah.
But I think from now
it's
like...
It's pretty far.
It's pretty far, but not. There's some other stuff that, like, for example, there was a lot of things that we saw earlier that still haven't been. How would you say they haven't even been pushed out? Yeah, for sure. A lot of technology and things like that that we were doing at the time, and ways we thought of leveraging it, still not. They don't exist. And I've seen some parts.
Well, they just don't want to. They don't want to. They don't want to lose that
control.
Their bread and butter. Yeah, I mean, yeah. Control and control equals money, right? Like, so it's like, why would I take? Why would I let this new device basically
destroy
completely me. Run me out of this business. Yeah.
Oh, those are the fucking meetings I would have. I would be invited to Warner Brothers CTO and they would fucking sit there. I'd sit at the fucking end of this long ass fucking damn table. And he's like, I'm like, all right, what the fuck is this? And there's like guards walking us up to the fucking room. I'm like, so what are we doing here? I just wanted to do some stuff with you guys. What's this? There's like, oh yeah, man, we got to watch it on kids like you, because last time a fucking kid tried some shit like that, his name was Sean Parker and it fucked us up. So we want to keep tabs on people that start asking questions like that.
Know.
Yeah. So
that's crazy.
That was pretty much it, man. So yeah, we started doing a bunch of shit like that. And now I'm just, I decided to push out the podcast, and I'm still working with some technology things. Cool. And I have some, I'm still have a lot of plans. I have my 5-year plans. I don't release them to everybody, but this is one little small thing out of it. Yeah.
Yeah. You can't do that. You know, one thing I learned, you know, so you just got to keep your plans to yourself and to your, you know, your very small team for a few reasons. One, your brain actually thinks that you achieved them if you continue to talk about them. and then you lose your motivation to actually do them because in your brain, because you know, the more you think about something, your brain doesn't know the difference between thinking and actually experiencing it.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to kind of keep those to a minimum. And then obviously once you tell somebody, like, they can steal it or they can, you know, it's gone. It's out of your control.
I think in the tech industry, one thing I've learned, I've learned a bunch
that's
of shit.
That's in the tech industry. It's like you're literally giving away your recipe and then to another restaurant.
I mean, you kind of end up having to do so. And what the tech industry prizes is that your idea isn't original necessarily. It's the execution.
It's the execution, right? Yeah. And that's what I was taught in film school. Like, and like people would be like, you stole my idea for a project because maybe two filmmakers would have a relatively similar script or something like that. And then so the teacher, you know, like was very adamant always about, hey, none of your ideas are original. Nothing you're going to write or ever create is going to be original. And people would get so mad. And it's the way you execute it. That's the only thing that's going to be, you know, original about your idea. And that really stuck with me to this day. So,
and that's the difference between Facebook. That's the difference between Twitter's, you know, founder. You know, when you got Mark Zuckerberg, you have Reid Hoffman of LinkedIn and things like that. That is the variance between them, is that their execution and their timing was right. And it fucking ended up working out. And we're Tom and them. It worked out a little bit for them and they got their cash out.
I know.
But it
sucks, right? I mean,
it's not where it needs to be. So
yeah, it is, you know, execution is everything, you know, and
it's hard to execute because sometimes a lot of things that you got to think about also money as well. Matt, like money can be a breaker into your execution. If somebody's got $1 billion, sometimes they can fucking kill you.
But you have to be smart. You have to be smart with the
what you have
development and what you have, and then bringing in resources stuff like that. I think ego is the key component. Whether you don't need people, you're too scared to ask, or you want to do it by yourself, whatever the case may be. I think that's really where that's what really hinders the end product in the long run. You know, because like Facebook or MySpace could have went and done the same thing that Facebook did and kind of whatever they did as far as business wise, but for whatever reason they didn't. You know what I mean? And
well, do you know the real reason?
No.
Well, the fucking real reason is Christy Wolf and Tom were actually coming up to Silicon Valley. They had met with Mark Zuckerberg and they just got on a plane and went back, and Intermix Media, whatever it was, in Beverly Hills, the company that was the parent company where they created MySpace out of, they had fucking sold it while they were coming, before they came back. So when they got off the fucking plane, it was sold, because the problem is they fucking built a company that was inside of another company. So their property was actually the other company's, Intermix. And Intermix had sold it to fucking, Murdoch, right? They sold it to fucking him. So when they got back off the plane, they're like, oh shit, we're going to buy this Facebook thing. I know this is probably going to happen for us. And when they get back off the fucking plane, they go into their offices and then, voila, hey guys, we fucking sold it to Fox. So
I mean,
but that laid the way for Facebook. If that never fucking happened,
yeah,
MySpace would still probably be around, and Facebook probably wouldn't.
Top 8.
Exactly. Actually,
your top 16.
These are the fucking facts. But that's kind of fucking what happened to them, man. So, yeah, it's a lot of fucking crazy shit that happened behind the scenes, and I've worked on some crazy shit.
Hey, we're in a crazy industry. We're choosing this industry. You know, I mean, there's something that in our brain or in our you know, emotional capacity that we need. We need this up and down roller coaster. Because if not, we would just go get a regular job, which most creatives or most people in the entertainment, you know, spectrum can't, or even tech, I think, you know, it's just, you can't do that day in, day out for a flat line. So one thing I realized is I'm absolutely shit crazy, and I'm fully aware and accept that. Yo, what up? This is Matt Alonzo, and you're watching Move Faces TV. Don't forget to check me out on the Kids in the Room podcast.
Boom!
Ladies and gentlemen, the Kids in the Room podcast.
Kids in the Room podcast.
That's right. That's right.
Brought to you by Move Faces TV.
Let's go.